Hello and welcome to Everything to Guppy, the podcast where we talk about every single item, every single enemy, every single everything in The Binding of Isaac. I'm William Hughes, and I'm joined, as always, by the Steve Wozniak of writing anodyne captions for existing newspaper comic strips, Gary Butterfield. Hi, Gary.
Yeah, hey.
So, Gary, I was listening to a popular video game podcast, which is to say a two-hour audio file in which grown men analyze children's toys. And I you know what? I heard my name on it. Isn't that funny?
Yeah. No, it wasn't funny at the time.
It did. Hey, Gary, it didn't seem funny at the time.
No, it was infuriating at the time and infuriating now as well.
Yeah. For listeners who, like me, don't listen to Watch Out for Fireballs regularly, because why do you need your beloved memories of Illusion of Gaia tainted by a 40-year-old man's... Sorry, 40...
Playing it.
Yeah.
Like, actually just playing it and talking about it. You wouldn't want that.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
There was a moment where you brought up the Lockhorns.
Yep.
And then Cole...
Which I co-own.
And then Cole made the worst mistake of his life.
Cole said something real stupid.
Said
real
something
fucking
that
stupid.
He said the kind of thing that in like, oh, in like a I don't want to go into hyperbole, but like in a movie, like it's a slasher movie or like a horror movie. And you said the thing that makes the horror movie villain do a machete on you.
It's telling Pearl that you're scared of her, or you're, you know, it's that kind of thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it was so calculated seeming, but Cole didn't know.
No, Gary,
but
no
it was
one...
precisely, you know, precisely engineered.
Yeah. I would argue
that kind of beautiful accident.
That part of the beauty of the moment is no one who is your enemy in the scenario we're about to talk about has calculated anything.
No, that you guys are fucking gormless. He said the wrong thing.
He said, you know, Gary, we don't have to. I have the audio all queued up to on my phone.
If you want to play it, you can play it. That's fine.
Yeah. We can in fact, since this is what the entirety of this episode of Guppy is going to be about, let's just go ahead and play the audio.
Okay.
I want to draw attention to Will's project of plausible Lockhorns.
Hold on. That's our project. I had exactly as much authorship of that. He just is on Twitter. Okay. We've been doing that in the Guppy channel, and I am at least as good as Will at that.
Okay.
He just likes taking things and claiming them. That is not Will's project.
Okay. Okay. So far.
Our plausible Garf, which we came up with on Everything to Guppy as well. But now he's like, I'm doing plausible Lockhorns. It's my thing. No. Yep.
No lies detected. Plus two. Gary.
I wasn't aware that I was stepping into a hairy issue. So,
exceedingly hairy. I've been doing plausible Lockhorns every day as well. I'm just not on Twitter.
Gotcha.
That's
right.
I love how defensive you got.
Like, it's like fucking mad. Somebody else in the Guppy channel were like, they listened to the show where we came up with the idea. It was also like, this is so good, Will. That's a cool idea. I'm like, fuck off, man. I was like right there. It was a podcast.
Shout out to Zach.
I've been doing it just as long.
Plus two. Reverse shout out to Zach. Shout down to Zach.
Just because you're louder doesn't mean it's yours.
Wise. Plus two, pass Gary.
All right, I'll not never mention plausible Lockhorns again.
I was also mad. No, you should mention them and do them because they're fun. It's just it belongs to all of us. Okay. I hate this boss fight.
Yeah, then we're going into those vampires.
Yeah, which is a perfectly
vampires.
Which is a perfectly fine boss fight, I think.
No, it's not. You haven't played it in 30 years. you don't know. You're just guessing.
Gary, would you? So you contend,
yes,
that nothing that you said in that clip was out of line or needlessly angry at a friend for not doing anything negative to you. The part where you said that I like to claim things doesn't doesn't feel like perhaps a bit of, I don't know what that was, Gary. I know I felt something when I heard it.
It was a little mean.
Mm-hmm.
It was a little mean. It was a little mean. I'll admit that it was a little mean.
Do you think it was a little true?
I think that it was misplaced anger.
Okay, good. So this is the first time I've heard you say something like misplaced in regards to the feelings that you're expressing here. And that's because that feels like really, a really good sign, buddy.
It's really mad. It's really anger at the Guppy Slack and Zach.
Yes.
It's people rushing over themselves to give you credit for ideas we co-created for some reason. And maybe there's a little bit of jealousy. Maybe I was misplacing some of my anger because I like that idea. I felt like we came up with it together and I want a little credit because I think it's fun and good. And I don't like that it's just being called your project.
Yeah, Gary. And I want to be really clear. I have never called it my project.
No, you're pretty good about that kind of thing. But you don't tell people, well, you know what? But you don't correct people. If somebody's in the Slack and they're just like, this is great, Will, it's good. You just kind of like move on.
Yeah, Gary, because I don't care about praise.
Maybe. So it is misplaced anger at the Guppy Slack presented at you.
And Cole.
And Cole for not knowing how to shut the fuck up and not bring it up.
Yeah.
But he couldn't have known. That's true. Yeah, you know what? You're correct. I was saying a lot of true things about the genesis of Plausible Lockhorns.
Uh-huh.
And the reputation it has. But they should not have been focused on you.
Yeah.
The reputation with Cole and Zach that it has. Its wide-ranging reputation among a couple of mentally ill people I know. That is why I did.
Gary, I'm so glad that we could bring this to a place of healing. I'm very happy with the fact I never have to do Plausible Lockhorns again, because every time I think about it now, it gives me a strange pit in my stomach, a little acid pouring into my gut.
I didn't want that, but this is really everyone's fault but mine.
Absolutely. Gary, I'm so glad we could come to the same conclusion here. Yeah. Because it's amazing.
I did have an emotional reaction to it. I was a little bit jealous. Okay. A little bit jealous. I didn't like this fun idea. I had a big plan where I was going to do like a graduated series of comics thing for Duckstream. And I had this like PowerPoint thing I was going
to
make.
Looking forward to it. I think you should do that. It'd be great.
I don't want to now, though, because it's just like, it's your thing. Again, not your fault, but with popular conception.
It really isn't. It's literally, Gary, this is your brain building a beautiful edifice of hate out of two sentences.
I know.
It's actually the most fucking Lockhorns thing ever.
Those sentences shouldn't have been uttered.
Okay.
I expect more from the people around me. They should know better. you know?
Oh, Gary. Anywho. Gary,
that is true, though. It was a fun moment in the episode a little bit, because once I got really mad. There was a genuine emotion.
Mm-hmm. Clear. Very clear.
I got backed off for it. But it wasn't, you know, in retrospect, not mad at you. Shouldn't have been mad at you. Shouldn't have yelled at you. Shouldn't have yelled at Cole. Should have taken that opportunity to yell at the Slack.
Yeah.
That's what I should have done.
It's always good to punch down at the Slack. They're giving you money. That they've put themselves in a low status position by default.
Subservient.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, it's true. So that is a lesson learned. That is a good lesson for me. On reflection, I was wrong.
Gary, I think all you have to do is just every day on Blue Sky, post your Plausible Lockhorn, and I won't post any Plausible Lockhorns, and then you will take ownership
I don't want the sole ownership. I like reading your Plausible Locks. Like, I want it to be like a thing that we both made, but then everyone can do, because I want to read more of them, because I think it's a fun game.
But Gary, what if mine are a little bit better than yours each time?
That's not true, though. I've seen yours. Sometimes they are, but sometimes mine are better. Like,
the most aggressive assertion in that whole bit is like, and I'm, if anything, better at him.
At least as good. That's not better.
Yes, it is. At least as good means everything I am doing is either as good or better than his.
But as good is implied in there.
Yeah.
You've given birth to some shit stinkers of Plausible Locks, and so have I. It's okay. The stakes are, the actual competition of it is low. I just want the thing to exist.
I really thought it was, man.
They're two very different framings of competition. I'm not interested in doing the thing best. I like the idea of it.
You just want the credit for the funny idea. Since the actual content isn't funny, it's just a funny idea.
The content is fun to do to me and also funny to me. I like them. I like seeing these things, and I think it's a really cool idea. it just, like, it felt like something kind of special. Like, I was like, oh, this is a neat thing to stumble upon as an idea to, as like a creative exercise to engage as a, at a work.
There
it
is
felt bigger than just the doing something better. Like, that is a low value carb to me. A cool carb is to come up with something like new.
There is a genuine sense I hear in your voice in that clip of you worrying you are being cut out of the ground floor of something big.
I do feel like that. I think it's a really cool idea. It could be a lesser Jackbox game.
Oh, it could be the worst game on Party Pack 12.
You know, it could be almost as good as racketeering, or bracketeering rather. It's just like, this is a fun idea. I don't know. It's definitely, you know what? You got me dead to rights in that this is exposing things about me in terms of like my specific mental picadillo things, because it never occurred to me, like, even though I know I said mine are at least as good, what I was defensive about that in that statement was about you owning it because you were better at it than me.
Gary, I finally made the connection. Do you understand you're living a life where the idea of plausible lockhorns is your gray matter? For Breaking Bad?
I will not go... Like, I was... It's funny that you brought that up, because when I was thinking about doing at least as good, I was thinking about, your meth is as good as mine.
Yeah.
Statements.
No, Gary, you are going full Walter White on the concept of plausible lockhorns.
I know. Which is better than meth. Less harmful. Way less profitable, though.
So far, yeah. It's actually...
It hasn't made cent one.
Yeah, and ultimately, it's a parody of an existing... I guess we could... Could we sell a plausible lockhorn? Does that count as fair use, you think?
We could sell it in conventions and stuff, like gray markets.
Gary, what if we finally did a convention for, did like a guppy panel at a convention, mm-hmm. and our only merch was lockhorns...
Mm-hmm.
with the text written in Comic Sans.
Yeah, fixed locks, plausible locks, alternate universe lockhorns. I would like it. Yeah, no, I did feel like I was losing something special.
Yeah, Gary, it's
worth. Here's the thing too. At no point during that do I want to cut you out of credit.
No, I know you don't. I know. Together. I absolutely know you like, don't.
Yeah, we developed that idea together, and I'm proud of our comic sensibilities and us discovering a cool, fun thing that could be a lesser Jackbox game together. I don't feel pride very often. I genuinely felt pride at this cool thing I'd never thought of before that was actually fun. And I liked it as a me and you thing. But I got mad because I didn't want it just to become a you thing. This is probably exactly what happened to Steve Wozniak.
It's exactly what happened to Steve Wozniak.
Yeah.
Well, Gary, sure. It's amazing. I cannot wait to see Seth Rogen play you in one of the several plausible lockhorns biopics that come out same year for some fucking reason.
I hope if that happens, there are people who play the lockhorns as well, because Paul Giamatti would be a really good Leroy.
I mean, yeah, I was going to like, we could have gone on a fantasy casting thing, but you just get Giamatti and Laura Linney back from Ben Franklin, and that's basically it. Fuck.
That's really good. Yeah. Who would play you?
Oh, I mean, again, if we could bring him down a couple more pegs, Jack Black's always there.
Yeah. Like a Jack Black and Seth Rogen.
Jack Black's still got that light in his eyes, like that. I think that's the only reason people still really cotton to him is like you can still see he could do something wild.
Can we put that out though? Like, can't Claptrap put that out?
I really hope
we need to have some L's.
Yeah,
extinguish that shit.
When was the last time he did something really good? You know, when was the last time Jack Black made a thing you really really liked?
Mr. Show.
You don't like School of Rock?
I've never seen it, actually.
It's cute. So. He's given a fun, good performance in it. He did Bernie after that. I like Bernie a lot.
Oh, Bernie's fun.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, Bernie's good. Yeah. But it may have been since then. He's fine and good in Brutal Legend.
Oh, he's also really good in Psychonauts 2, which is an underrated game. Have you played Psychonauts 2?
I haven't.
Yeah, I don't want to get into another like serious video game conversation with you. Psychonauts 2, I was surprised by how much I liked, given that I have soured quite a bit on Psychonauts 1.
I've heard that it's way better.
Yeah,
than the first one, which is good. Are we okay? Do you forgive me for freaking out and misplacing my anger?
I don't generally bother with the concept of forgiveness, but I do acknowledge that I've milked all the comedy and pathos out of this concept that I'm likely to.
Okay. I will settle for that.
Yeah, great. Embryo. Monster yeah. Rush, Gary. We're Monster, yeah, Monster Blitz.
We are cruising. The little babies that are inside a blastocyst.
Yeah, which sometimes spawn all on their own.
Mm-hmm. And they're cute.
They are very cute. They're little, they are recreating a phase before growing human babies or whatever you want to call, I guess embryos, have legs. They just look like little bouncy worm guys.
Yeah. Yeah. We all came from this.
Sorry. I don't want to call them babies, Gary, because then I'm suggesting that life begins at conception.
No. That's not the official guppy policy.
No. Gary, what is the official guppy policy on abortion? The more, often, the better.
Yeah, exactly. Often and bricks for all.
Bricks?
Yep.
What's that mean?
For all. Oh, Ben Folds 5 abortion song.
Oh, reference. Okay. Yeah, now I get it. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. That's weird, Gary, because I'm the bigger Ben Folds 5 fan on the podcast. Unless you're about to get real fucking mad at me for saying that. Have I taken your Ben Folds fandom from you?
You can't own a fandom. let's not be silly now. You can't own a fandom. You can own an idea. And you can co-develop an idea. I think that's so weird that was such a huge single. It never leaves my brain.
I mean, it's really catchy.
Brick and Lightning Crashes are stuck, live in my head 24/7.
Lightning Crashes is wilder to me because if you, I think about the single line,
placenta falls
to the floor.
Yeah. Just
popping I have this boba. Incredibly vivid memory of sitting, it's like fall 2001, and I am sitting on a bus on a Saturday morning having to ride to a marching band show, and there is, the sun has not come up because we had to get on the bus at like 5 in the morning to get to this marching band thing, and just listening to that song on my little portable radio and just thinking, did he say placenta?
Yeah, it's one of the only big singles that has placenta in it.
It might be the most famous song featuring by name the placenta.
Yeah, it's track one, disc one on Placenta Songs, the box set. That's for sure.
There's a dirty little pun in there.
Yeah, the box set.
Yeah.
Hey.
I'm glad that we can come together to make a vagina pun.
I've always enjoyed that euphemism. It's really general.
It's just
like container or something.
Yeah, no, it does recontextualize the entirety of female sexuality as a whole, the cum go in. So
yeah, it's like a storage space. It reminds me of when I first found out that shipping containers were just called containers.
Yeah.
A lot of the time. And I watched a Jason Statham movie, and at one point there's a DVD chapter that's like Fight Among the Containers. And that just made me laugh a lot because containers is so general. It sounds, Gary, like he's just in a room full of Tupperware or something.
Gary, I'm pretty sure that is the first anecdote anyone has ever told about moving through the DVD menu for the transporter.
Yeah, exactly. Transporter. Thank you. There's also Fight Amongst the Grease is another chapter in that where he gets all oiled up and slides around shooting.
Gary, can you also say your social security number from memory, or do you have to look that one up because you've put all your memories, all your memory points into DVD chapter titles?
Chapter titles for the transporter?
Yeah.
No, I know my social. It's 111-222 Gary.
That's great.
Yeah. I got a personalized one. They rejected if you asked for too many dirty ones, though.
Yeah. Oh my God. But you ever like trawl through that site that shows all the rejected social security numbers? It's funny. You see some funny stuff in there.
You get some funny stuff, and you get some stuff that's not that funny, but people post it anyway.
Yeah.
You know, you get some of that stuff.
Well, you got to post something new every day.
You do have to post something new every day.
Gary, do you,
otherwise you lose credit.
Do you follow that Super Mario Brothers fact Twitter account?
Or the Super Mario Broth?
Yeah.
Yes. I used to, no longer, cause I don't think they're on Blue Sky.
They're all, that's a good impulse. They have officially, this is a weird personal beef, but like, what is this show if not that? They have really, really, really run out of things to say.
They lost it.
About, I think they just said all the things. And so now sometimes they post their Paper Mario webcomic.
Uh-oh.
And then it's other things where it's like, perhaps this supposes that blah, blah, blah. It's like, buddy, I'm just here to read about a weird sprite thing.
Yeah.
And you're not giving me that weird sprite content.
We've all seen the original Yoshi a long time ago.
We've
all and now that we've seen weird skinny Yoshi. Yeah, we've all seen Yoshi 1, and now there's not a whole lot. Diminishing returns going on there. Yeah.
So, Gary, this is just a rundown of Twitter accounts that I no longer enjoy.
I haven't been, I popped back on Blue Side briefly. I haven't been enjoying accounts very much.
I'm sorry, man. That's a real shame.
It does. It sucks. Every once in a while you get a good joke. I like looking at Rory Blank's t-shirt designs.
Mm-hmm.
The Onion posts a funny thing sometimes.
Yeah, Onion's still going strong. Very happy to see that. My I believe it's all of my former comrades. I think they all got kept in the sale. So
I like that print subscription thing. I'm going to get that when we move.
Yeah, that's great.
I like that idea. Yeah, it'll be really nice to just get a funny little paper. How novel.
It's fun to get a funny little paper.
It is. It's fun to take a jagged little pill. You ought to know more than anyone. What does the embryo do?
It just kind of bounce around, and if it touches you, it hurts you.
He's cute.
Oh, weirdly, I encountered these guys way before I ever fought Blastocyst. I also fought like the mini boss version of Blastocyst before I ever fought. For a long time in my original Isaac run, Blastocyst was the one boss. I never got whatever the unlock is for beating all the bosses from that floor, because Blastocyst would just never spawn as the boss.
I think he's low-key one of the rarest bosses in the game.
Well, because it's one of those floors where even though it's two floors for the chapter, the second
one is mom.
Is always going to be. I think is he depths or womb?
He's womb.
Okay, yeah, then it's always it's always mom's heart or it lives. And I just always got Loki or Fred.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a bunch of people, and then they add more. You can get like the Bloat and Mama Gertie and Skolex and shit.
Yeah.
They ended up adding more, so it's really hard to get. Yeah. Poor Blastocyst.
Poor me not getting whatever that fucking unlock was. Yeah.
True. Poor Will.
Poor Gary, if we could just interject a few more
poor Wills. Will.
Yeah.
Poor Will. Poor Will.
You don't have to feel bad for me. I'm having a good life for the most part.
No, it's but everyone deserves our empathy. Our sympathy, except some people. Next up, we got the spider.
Oh, yeah. We're into a whole good class. Spiders, the signature enemy of the very first Wrath content of the Lamb. Pack. Yeah, Wrath of the Lamb.
Yeah, the Wrath of the Lamb enemies here. And early on, a pretty consistent source of getting hit. They move really erratically. Like, spiders ain't no joke.
Yeah, spiders are basically, they are positioned both in their visuals and in how they are used in enemy designs as a contrast to flies, which I guess, a fly is basically the signature enemy of this game, right? It's the goop.
Yeah, or the baseline enemy, the atom.
The spider presents an alternate model of that, where it is still just a little thing that just kind of moves around the room kind of towards Isaac, except in this case, they move erratically at angles.
They're also a little tankier.
They're a little tankier. They can take a couple, like maybe one or two more baseline hits.
Do you want to hear some Gary trivia?
Gary, I love your Garivia. Geralt of Garivia.
I was working on it, but you got there quicker. I do not have any allergies that I know of, except spiders. When I was young, I got bit by some kind of insect, and it caused this huge swelling. So like a huge swollen part on my thigh. Maybe as big as a volleyball, like not quite far as out, but in terms of width, so just imagine a huge bump, like a second thigh growing out of my thigh or a vanishing twin. And the doctor guessed that it was a spider bite that I was allergic to. And since then I've been like, I'm allergic to spider bites and I stay away from spiders. I bet you that was something different. And I probably have been bit by a spider since then. And that was just a weird mystery lump.
Yeah, Gary. I mean, that's terrifying.
It was gross. It was weird. One of the very few, I knew it was bad because I got taken to the doctor. As a kid, if I saw a doctor, even as a child, I knew that meant something was serious because ordinarily I wouldn't go.
Yeah, and to be fair, most of the times kids don't actually need to go to the doctor.
No. I don't know. That's true. It's you. Same thing with you know, like generally you know when you're someone's sick.
Yeah, know? Like Gary, I think we should really the pivot, of course, is us giving parenting advice,
medical advice. Oh, okay.
It's Porky both.
Dose. Yeah.
Yeah. It's we're gonna become. Now you keep Bone saying saws. You keep saying the pedo boys, short for pediatrician.
Yeah.
I keep feeling like there's something wrong with that, but I can't actually clue into what it is.
It's catchy.
It's really catchy. It's short. It makes it sound like mm-hmm. we're on the move.
We're on the move. We could also talk about walking. Let's go through the other things we could talk about with this title, because if we use this name, we have a built-in pivot.
And again, start out Gary, could you say the name so I have it real clear for the court case?
Yeah, it is the Pedo Boys.
There we go. Sure.
We start out talking about pediatrician advice. Uh-huh. Then we pivot to walking. Now you do one.
That's kind of a paraphilic sexual interest in children.
Oh, shit. I was going to say,
about that's why Gary, that's why.
Yeah. That's the right. That's what about, why. What if we, you know, cause you know how you get to decide how you spell something when you say it. What if we then talked about Geppetto?
Oh, that's good. That's good. Now, Gary, I will say if we're selling t-shirts, we do have to actually decide how to spell it.
Unless we invent sound shirts.
Gary, I don't, I, you know, obviously, Gary, I'm going to go ahead and say pedophilia is bad and not funny. But the idea of selling to our listeners a shirt that with a big bright logo that's just the Pedo Boys.
Yeah.
And never somebody wearing them ourselves and just selling them to real guppy perverts.
Not selling them in public or anything either. And just every once in a while, somebody in the Slack will post a picture of them with a shirt.
And a black eye, at least.
Yeah. Like, in custody.
Yeah.
Post a mugshot from time to time. Yeah.
Gary, I don't think... Gary, sorry? Sorry. Mm-hmm. I know we were doing a fun bit where we were making fun of pedophilia because it's the last taboo. Oh, damn, it just clicked away. I had an ad for a book that was like three-card murder. It was like it was like a murder novel, but with like set in the world of magicians. And Gary, all we need to do now is write murder novels set in the world of magicians.
Yeah, this is three-card murder, a book by J.L. Blackhurst.
Okay, good. You're getting that same one. Excellent.
No, I Googled it.
Yeah. Oh, man. Right. I know there's already a couple Phoenix Wright cases. There's like... in the later Phoenix Wright games, there's always one that takes place at a magic show where part of the solving the case is working out how the magic trick works.
That's fun.
Yeah, it's a great premise to fuck around with a mystery because it's got an inherent like misdirect built into it.
Yeah, this is a well-loved book. This is 4 stars on Amazon.
Ah, damn. Let's get some Goodreads quotes.
Yeah, let's look inside.
Three-card murder Goodreads. You can't trust fucking Amazon anymore. 3.6.
Yeah. Okay.
On Goodreads. Thoroughly entertaining read.
I can find an Audible sample, but when I do look inside, it just shows me the cover. Oh, no, here we go. Let's see
now, you're not going to listen to that right now.
No. I was going to read a chapter from it, or read a selection from it. But I can't.
Yeah. Well, you know, let's see. Let me just read the top review. A good cheeky listen. The narrator does a good job of the story, which is three murders wet. It seems impossible for the killer to have got out unseen. They're being investigated by Tess and seem to be linked to her half-duster Tess, which is on the oversight of the law. Sarah is still family, but they haven't seen each other since Tess protected Sarah and made her choice to be a police officer.
I will say the prose doesn't seem great to me.
Okay.
Here. The delighted shrieks of children playing on the sand below and the sweet smell of fried dough, spun sugar, and salty sea air made the declaration seem like a promise. Today is your lucky day. Giant multicolored soft toys lined the top of the stall, framing the girl with the dark dreadlocks who was restacking the shiny tins with a practiced flick of the hand. There is a everything has an adjective problem with this.
Every book in my mind is compared to the greatest book of all time, which is the book that Billy Crystal's character is writing in Let's Throw Mama from the Train.
I don't remember the book part of that. I've seen that movie. I remember mostly the sleeping with her eyes open.
Ultimately, the line of it becomes the night was sultry. But that's only after Mama gives him the word. He spends the whole book, the whole movie trying to find a better name for it. And then she just goes, sultry!
King Kai?
I know, Gary, you don't have to call it out every time a character is King Kai, okay? I have an Ann Ramsey. It's just King Kai has colonized large parts of my vocal cords. Let me try it again.
No, it sounded like both of them. I wasn't making fun of you. That they sound the same.
I got to start from an Owen. Okay, you know how with Gambit, you've got to start from imagining a large child eating shrimp?
Yep.
Owen!
That did sound a little bit less like King Kai.
The night was sultry. Nope. Fuck. Get fucked, King, Will.
King Kai is an intrusive force and we should exercise it.
He doesn't need to exercise, Gary. He's already an incredible fighter.
Is he? He looks like a chubby catfish.
I believe it's strongly implied that if King Kai ever actually fought, which he probably does in like Super or something, he would kick everybody's ass. Gary, I used to really pride myself on my Ann Ramsey. Also, of course, the lady from Goonies.
The Owen was good.
Yeah. But yeah.
Sometimes you only have one word of an impression, one phrase. That's okay.
I used to torment myself trying to do a Professor Farnsworth, man.
Farnsworth is really tough.
Can you give me your best Farnsworth right now?
Good news, people. Yeah, no.
Good
news. Yeah, that's really hard. Shit.
Hey, Fred Schneider, what are you sciencing?
Good news. Rest of the B-52s were opening for REM.
Good news, everybody. Nope.
Good news, everybody.
It's Billy West.
Good God.
A generational talent.
One of the hardest impressions I've ever tried to do.
It's really hard because you just think it's just like an old guy, but it's not. There's a lot of nuance to it.
Good news. Yeah.
No, worse.
I can do every other impression I can do better than that one.
It's
good news.
It feels like you should be able to just bust it out, right?
Yeah. It's a really distinct voice.
Billy West, a generational talent.
Yeah. Wow, that's good. Fuck. Yeah.
Gary, what is Spider Big?
Oh, this is spider but big. It erratically moves around the room, you know, like the little spider does. But this guy, he's got a secret. He's sneaking into a movie. He's two spiders, actually.
And yeah, some people might suggest he's a kind of Vincent Adult Man type.
Yeah, he's Vincent Adult Man. I do not want a spider that if you kill it, turns into two spiders in real life.
That would be fairly worrying, I would say.
It does mean unlimited spiders, but I don't know what I would do with unlimited spiders. It's not like a soup or a salad or a breadstick.
I mean, if they were silk generating spiders, people are always trying to tell you about fucking spider silk.
That's true. It's got high tensile strength.
I mean, it's possible any spider in my house might have this trait since I do not kill spiders. It is my only ethical stance.
I used to kill spiders because of that allergy I mentioned earlier. Sure. I used to feel justified in it, but no longer do I kill them. Now I just leave them be. And if Jessica wants to hunt them, I'm not going to intervene.
Of course. That's natural.
Yeah. That's nature, you know, and I don't want to get between Jessica and food.
No, that does seem like a way to get nipped.
You lose a hand.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, this turns into two regular spiders. So these guys are a problem. They usually spawn with little spiders and sometimes spawn in multiples. So you got stages here.
And they take a lot of hits to kill.
Yes. They're way tankier than a regular spider.
And again, there's a whole alternate version of these starting floors called the cellar and its various derivations, which basically replace all flies with spiders, which means you are going to be fighting a lot of these with base damage.
Base damage and tiers really sucks with these things.
Yeah.
I think that sometimes a spider can have other spiders on it because I think when they have like the egg sac, I think when they're about to drop it, I think those spiders can be alive. I feel like I've seen a video in early internet days of somebody like hitting a spider and it bursting into a bunch of little spiders.
I mean, that certainly seems like something that would be in my nightmares.
It's really horrible. You know,
I've decided that I can't fix any of my personality defects, but I can maybe come more to terms with not being scared of spiders and acknowledging that the fear at this point is at least partially intellectual. And thus can be defeated by the intellect, of which mine is paramount.
Can you extend that to centipedes? Because I can't.
No, I, Gary. They yeah, move I, like little fucking yeah. nightmares. A spider mean, a will at least spiders. Stay still most of the time.
Yeah. A centipede's getting sprayed with something.
I still don't kill the centipede. I still don't kill the centipede. But the first time I saw a house centipede in my place in Chicago, it was revelatory.
Yeah, those things are wrong. I can't handle those guys. I would love to have peace with them, but
like not to just be people who quote, I think you should leave all the time, but in the world there were monsters. There was monsters. Yes.
Yeah. Ugh. Yeah.
Gary, Ted Lasso's coming back.
Oh, hey. Is it a good time to catch up?
I think it's a great time to catch up. You're finally like how much have you watched so far?
Zero.
Yeah, then now would be a good time to probably catch up to see some before they make a fourth season that no one seems to want. Except
nobody liked season three, it seemed like. It lost a lot of its luster.
And also, it ended with the character going home and resolving all of his conflicts and being done.
He's going to have to get back into soccer like John Wick. He's going to get a call and he's going to go down to his garage and bust open the floor and pull out a soccer ball.
John Wick is so bad at quitting things.
He's really bad at quitting things. He doesn't do it.
He's that guy who, it's like, it's like the second week of classes and like, oh, look, it's one of the seniors, last year's seniors. He came back to visit to see his favorite teachers because college has been scary and he doesn't know anyone there and he wants to be in an environment where people actually liked or celebrated him.
That shit's so pathetic.
I did it once.
Yeah.
I was home and on a day when class was in session. So I was like, hey, I'll pop by for a second.
Did everyone applaud when you came in?
It was not that. No.
Yeah.
Emotionally, I would say.
Yeah.
It was not. Yeah. I don't have a lot of memories of it, which means it was either nothing or I've 404'd it on purpose. So I'm sure it was fine.
The reason why I never did that was because in my hometown we had Cornfest and you'd run into all of your teachers that you liked there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you get at Cornfest?
Free corn. Unlimited free corn.
Now corn can come in a lot of different forms, Gary. What kind of free corn were you getting here?
Corn on the cob.
Mm-hmm.
That has been boiled and has a big public dressing station that got really disgusting and full of bees really quickly.
What all is on the station?
Butter, salt, pepper.
No sugar, no honey, no.
Not when I was corn festing.
Mm-hmm.
It's a pretty conservative little town.
Sure.
You know, that's not proper corn. The weirdest thing was there's the big free corn boil and you go through the line, you get a corn and you go back to the line and get more corn if you want. And then there would be people nearby selling corn for $1. Which, like, $1 is a fine price for a corn on the cob.
Absolutely. What was different about their corn?
Nothing. It was
they weren't grilling it or anything?
No, it was just kind of like a fast pass. You know?
Sure.
Yeah. And those would be throughout. So, yeah, that's what was a corn fest. And then this year, Sugar Ray was at corn fest.
So and was they attacked by back. Bees?
I don't think Sugar Ray was attacked by bees this time. Okay. Not yet.
Gary, right, what's Sugar Ray's big hit?
I just wanna fly.
Okay, that's what I thought.
They also might do every morning. Every morning there's an angel standing in front of a four-post bed.
Mm-hmm. Gary, when we do probably do karaoke this year at Duckstream, could I get you? Do you feel like you're comfortable politically with doing Ba Wa Ta Ba?
Thinking about that.
I think it has to be if Trump loses.
If he wins, I'm not going to do a victory lap.
No.
Like,
or maybe that's your big pivot, buddy.
Yeah. I get a grift. You know? Get into
Gary,
the grift.
I keep thinking I got to grift more.
You don't grift enough.
I have a real constitutional, like, every now and then I'll just like, we'll talk on when I'm doing my streams, like I don't, monetize my streams at all because the idea of someone having to watch an ad to see me fuck around in Elden Ring is like anathema to my entire
soul.
Feels
bad.
Yeah. Yeah. But everyone, just do a Ko-Fi or something. No. I have a job.
Yeah.
This is entertainment.
Two jobs. Yeah.
Oh, I forgot this is work.
Yeah.
Navigating the labyrinth of Gary Butterfield.
Yeah. It's a beautiful little place though.
You know what, Gary? Oh man, Gary, you got that, I'm not telling tales out of school, but your new place do have backyard.
It does. And it's a beautiful backyard.
Maze.
It does look like ruins. It might be able to make a maze.
Have we talked about how disappointing modern mazes are, Gary?
No.
You can look up mazes or labyrinths in like Portland, and they're just floor designs.
Yeah, we used to have a lot of those in my hometown as well, home of Cornfest, and they suck. Like a little walking mandala.
We must have talked about this when we did the corn maze.
Yeah, I thought of something though.
Yeah.
Now that I've closed on that house, we can talk about how ridiculously it was staged.
We can finally talk about the fact that you sent me pictures of the house.
Yes.
And the only thing I asked you about was the fact that prominently placed on a coffee table in the picture was the M&M biography.
They did have the M&M biography. At first I thought, oh, that wasn't there when I came back, but they had just, somebody else who had looked at the place had put something else on top of it.
Yeah.
So it was still there. Or the person who staged it came back and was like, oh shit. And put a magazine on top of it. But there's also the Trump book.
Oh, great.
In the kitchen, in the pantry.
So you opened a pantry and just sitting there was the Art of the Deal or a biography or something?
A newer one, a newer Trump book. And then like with just, you know, shit, like miscellaneous stuff. Like, you know how in Better Call Saul, he's in the apartment and he finds that bowl full of those little balls?
Yeah.
You know, that kind of shit. That's what staging apartments is like. So it was like a pantry with a Trump book, like a little bowl full of balls, and then maybe like a tiny statue of an angel. Just really? Miscellaneous clues.
That, well, I mean, I don't think they're not clues to the people who live there. I think they're clues
to the people who staged it.
Yeah. Or just like what? Okay. So I'm trying to appeal to all people in the universe. So I got to put a Trump book for the Trump people.
Mm-hmm.
And then what's the opposite? Do you think there's a lot of Eminem fans who like Trump?
I think so.
Probably, yeah. If your favorite rapper is a white guy from Detroit, you might have some problems with people who are not white.
And he's real, you know, cancel, trickle wording, stuff like that. Like he's real, people are too offended now.
Hey man, he's complicated. You know, I don't want to paint with a broad brush here. He don't you think you and he can find some common ground in your love of Vemin?
Of what?
Vemin.
Vemin?
The big gooey space monster with the tongue and stuff. Vemin?
I don't know what Vemin is.
It's me saying Venom wrong, man. I didn't think it was that. I didn't think I was leading you. Welcome to my devious puzzle, Gary. I've spoonerized two fucking letters.
We relied on me remembering that Eminem did like a Venom song.
I'm sorry, and Gary. I've never been able to forget the fact that he did very, very, very pro-Venom song.
It got supplanted with me with the Run the Jewels Venom song, which is a band I actually like. So it's the only cure for a bad Venom song with a gun is a good Venom song with a gun.
You don't like the Eminem Venom song?
I don't remember it. I don't remember it.
Hold on.
It's pro-Venom though?
You know what? I believe he is imagining himself as Venom to some extent.
Sounds about right.
If memory serves, in the video, people are possessed by Eminem and start doing antisocial Eminem type things when the Eminem.
What's the Eminem Venom? Venom?
Venom, Venomen?
Venom.
Entimans.
Entimans. Once Entimans gets their kinky hands onto him.
Hold on. Let me
see what
the
geniuses have to say about this.
This is an ad. This is not the Eminem song.
This is a good song, Eminem.
Right? Doesn't it make you mad when you like the song in the ad?
Mm-hmm.
This is also not the Eminem song. I don't have a Ko-Fi, so I don't have the hold. Shit for the strong-willed
when the world gives you a raw deal. Set you off till you scream, piss off, screw you. You belong.
Gary, you hear how you got quiet because you started enjoying the song?
I was just reading along the lyrics. Oh. I have the this song has like seven verses.
Well, there's really a lot intense to say about how Eminem and Venom are similar.
Yeah. I said knock knock with the devil in alien E.E. Elliott foam home.
You know, you're in really good lyrical hands when your hook starts with the same line as a joke a child can memorize.
Yes. Yeah. Also, when you have mitochondrial.
Is mitochondrial in there?
Yeah, it's in that first thing. It's when something's in your mitochondrial because it's latched onto you like knock, knock, let the devil in.
I got to tell you, Gary, I wasn't listening to the actual lyrics. You caught me.
You're arrested by the beat. Rested by the beat. I think that Eminem and I could probably find something to talk about if we were like stuck on an elevator or something like that. You know?
All right. Ever hang out. Let's do the improv.
All right. Can I be Gambit?
No.
Okay.
You be Gary, I'll be Eminem.
Okay. All right. We're on an elevator.
Yep.
I won't draw attention to the fact that I just got in an elevator with Eminem.
Oh, very cool. Very cool move.
It is what I do. I leave celebrities alone. it's a policy. What? I'm trying to be an accurate M&M meeting here. Elevator stopped.
Oh, so in your mind, the elevator has to have some sort of serious problem in order for you to talk to M&M at all.
Yes. We get stuck in it for an indeterminate amount of time.
Great.
Yeah. maybe
what a fun day for M&M.
What, 14 more minutes, maybe? Okay. Elevator stopped.
Oh, fuck.
What?
Huh. Do you have any signal?
No. No.
Oh, yeah, me either. Hey. Is this one of the ones that has a little phone in it?
No. It'd be too easy. There's a button.
Sorry, what?
Did you say it'd be too easy? Yeah, it'd be too easy for you to escape our conversation, Mr. M.
Oh, fuck.
No, that's the narrator.
Oh, God, not again! Not again! Yeah. It was you!
You forgot about Stan? You forgot about Stan!
Pull off the mask, you're Devin Sawa. Yeah, I don't want to be trapped in an accident-prone situation with Devin Sawa. He gets Final Destination.
Yeah, and Dido is on the roof of the elevator, like a spider crawling around.
Gary, I can't imagine a scarier situation than to be in like a trapped elevator and then just to hear faintly.
Like as you're talking to Eminem in the elevator, she just pops her head down. Gary, like the grudge.
I wish Eminem was actually cool so we could get him to make this like comedy or die video.
He would yell at us so bad even just for approaching it. Like this would offend him and I would not understand why. He'd be really mad.
Oh, I don't want to do the improv anymore, Gary. We already found the funny.
Yeah, I know. If I was stuck in an elevator with Dido, I wouldn't recognize Dido, I don't think.
I don't think I could clock Dido by sight, no.
No, not even close.
A wispy blonde woman who's gotten more angular with age, one assumes?
That seems about right. She's kind of got like an aunt haircut now. So current Dido has, like, she looks like an aunt to me.
You know what? Dido looks nice. She looks like she's having an okay time.
No, Dido seems fine to me. I don't think I could pick her out of a lineup, you know?
No, she does kind of look like she could be one of those conservative commentator ladies who is surprisingly virulent on all progressive issues.
Yeah. Yeah. Did you know that one of those ladies did a parody of This Is America? That Childish Gambino?
Song? Oh, did they do it recently or was this back when the song came out?
It was back when the song came out.
I might have seen that and then put it in the same hole where I keep going back and having Mrs. Utley not be very happy to see me.
It's excruciating. I remember when it happened and I was reminded of it because it was part of a compilation of a Catatonic Youths thing on YouTube.
Gary, can I briefly break in?
Yeah.
Ms. Utley, I apologize. And Dr. Utley now, I think. She got her doctorate. Oh.
There we go. But yeah, what a tone deaf, awful thing to do. Can you imagine? It's really bad.
Taking what was already an incredibly politically charged, grabbing the moment song and then, yeah, that seems pretty bad.
It's awful. Like the most zeitgeist song that I can think of.
That's the worst thing I've seen a conservative person do since Lauren Boebert disrespected Beetlejuice.
Yeah.
Or gave him a great compliment.
Now that I know the guy who played Beetlejuice in that play, now, not know him, but I've seen him. I would be really curious to see what would happen if Beale just noticed that actor noticed it, because he's a real, you know, he plays Beetlejuice, the big attention guy.
Uh-huh.
I imagine he'd call attention to it.
Are you talking about Alex Brightman?
I think so. Is that the guy's name?
Was Brightman doing that show? I think that was several years. So, I'm sorry, Gary, I've got crap in my throat. That was way down the line of the Beetlejuice stage musical. I don't think Brightman was still playing the character at that point.
He played the character when I saw Beetlejuice, and I saw Beetlejuice like a year after that controversy.
Oh, fair enough. Fair enough.
Yeah.
Did you see it in New York, or did you see it when it came through Portland?
No, I saw it in Portland, but I'm looking at Alex Brightman right now, and this is the guy who was our guy. And I think one of the reasons why Liv was excited is because it was original cast touring.
Okay, fair enough. Okay.
So I think so, but I mean, don't quote me on that, but I'm pretty sure. This looks exactly like the dude.
He's very good in the episode, the Sondheim parody episode of Documentary Now.
It definitely was him, because there was a meet and greet you can do with him, it looks like.
Oh. But you didn't meet and greet him?
No.
And you were about to use the drive-by character assassination on this guy, so.
Oh, he would really, really make hay out of Lauren Boebert giving a hand job in the audience, I think.
Gary, did you hate the theater kids in your high school, or did you just try to stay away from them?
Some of them I was jealous of.
Uh-huh.
Because they
Gary, this has been a really big episode for you admitting the J word.
It is kind of. Maybe I had a breakthrough while I was sleeping last night.
Oh, isn't that? Maybe I had some dream therapy. Dream? Yeah, I mean, that's the dream.
You know, there's always people are always talking about the dream police, but ACAB. How about the dream therapist who come through and fix you while you're sleeping? Resented jealousy, not just pure jealousy.
Sure.
I had a lot in common with a lot of those people, but they hated me at my guts because I was a shitty little poor kid, and I was not I was not a good teen. Mm-hmm. You know, I was prickly as a teen, but they were like several of them were pretty mean to me. So mm-hmm. part of it was like, oh, I like all the smart stuff too, but I'm not in the classes you're in. And you look down on me because I wear the same clothes every day because I have no money. So I remember being like, they would talk about stuff that'd be funny and I would try to join in and couldn't. And that gave me feelings at the time. I remember very specifically some of these kids in the locker room. And I don't know how they got away with this because it seems like the kind of thing gets you beat up. They started doing quotes from Holy Grail. Mm-hmm. From Monty Python. I was a teenager. I liked Holy Grail. And I started kind of joining them, and I got one of the biggest looks of disgust I've ever received from a human being.
Mm-hmm.
And that, you know, big feelings around that as a kid.
Mm-hmm. This is really good. This is really good work. And I think it's going to be really helpful going forward. Do you feel like most of the hostility you bring to me on a minute by minute basis is because I was a theater kid and you're getting to exercise those feelings?
No.
No?
Okay. No. I don't really think of you as a theater kid.
I
know you were one.
Oh, big
kid. No, I believe it. But I don't feel like you've got that going on now. I don't think it doesn't play into my current mind palace of will.
Lead in the school play, man.
The what play?
It was the old version, like the original play version of Cheaper by the Dozen. We talked about it before. I was supposed to kiss the actress playing my wife and instead just ducked my head to the side.
Yeah, dodged it.
Dodged it.
You did a frame perfect parry of
Gary, if you want to see someone really speed run not kissing a girl in high school, yeah. You could just play the game tape of my entire life.
Yeah, summer Will done quick. This introduces this idea of Will as therapist. Mm-hmm. Like, I know that you wouldn't see a therapist, but thinking about you as a therapist is really fascinating.
It's fascinating to me that you haven't realized that that's what Guppy is.
That's all Guppy is.
It's entirely what Guppy is.
I don't think so.
So, Gary, do you feel like if we showed those kids now what you've made of your life?
I canonically know that they have turned around.
Okay.
You know, several of them on Facebook, there's a couple of them that are listeners.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody on Facebook, or on Blue Sky, I was talking to one of them and I was like, you know, and I was, feeling like this is not good behavior. I don't stand by this thing I just did. I'm going to tell you right now, mm-hmm. but I said, you know, we were talking back and forth and I was like, yeah. And just while I got you, sorry for being such a weirdo in high school. which I don't, you know, that's not a good, that's not good behavior.
No, not
proud of that. Not proud of that. It was a mistake. Mm-hmm. And they were just like, oh, dude, you don't have nothing to apologize for. The only thing you have to apologize for is not making more episodes of File Underwater. And I was like, aw,
sweet. And Gary, when you masturbate to that moment now, do you imagine this person as their younger self or their adult self?
Well, I can't come if it's their adult self.
The pedo boys!
Yes!
Yay!
Yay, mind meld callback.
Oh, we really shouldn't make that joke.
I know. But it's the track was already laid. The road was there.
That, yeah, but we also laid the track, buddy. We are both the road builders and the road drivers. What can change the nature of a
man? yeah. Shout out to Omar.
Gary, what if a spider was also Aragorn?
Aragorn. Oh, then it would be a Strider.
There we go, Gary. We got back to a monster.
Yeah. I scrolled down. I thought you were going to do the wrap up. So
no, we're at 55 minutes. We got about a minute or two left before we do that.
This is a new spider. This was introduced with the downpour.
Yeah, uh-huh. It's a wet spider.
Yeah, they make these. They're little water spiders that skate around on water. It's a real cute Mario enemy. Pops up from time to time.
True.
These things. I've never seen one in real life. I think I'd be pretty weirded out.
I mean, it's just one more reason not to go in the water, and I don't need those.
Let me pitch you a something from a low-budget horror movie that'd work really well.
Yeah, Gary?
Someone takes a bath. They go under the water, close their eyes. When they come out of the water, the surface of the water is full of these things.
Or they're underwater, open their eyes, and they just see them start to, like, pour in and start crawling, like, just covering the surface of the water.
Yep. Yeah, or it's just black, and then they have to, you know, they emerge, and... Yeah.
I'm really into that shot from in the water looking up through the light and just seeing one, and then two, and then 100 just moving around, and knowing you can't really surface without touching them.
Yeah, you can't really tell. Somebody once told me a story about that with jellyfish, where they had swum out to sea and then looked back at the coast, and there was full of jellyfish. Like, jellyfish had come in.
Mm-hmm.
And they had to kind of basically do a Mario 1 underwater level to, like, squeeze around them.
Now, avoiding the jellyfish is more like Mario 3.
You're right. There aren't jellyfish in the... there are those little squids. Yeah. But these were stationary.
Gary, and thank you for being big enough to admit the correction.
Well, the I come to you for Super Mario Broth.
And
like those kind of facts
therapy.
Are...
And therapy.
And therapy. And friendship. And a delightful hour once a week where I learn a little bit about myself. I learn a little bit about you.
I try not to let you learn things about me, but I'm sorry if that filter's breaking.
I know a lot about you.
You're really getting back into the Steve Wozniak vibes here.
Let's not get it twisted.
Hey man,
I know a lot about you.
Hey man, I know. I'm the only one here who fucking knows you.
Yeah, let's not get crazy here. Somebody should take that spider idea, though. That spider idea. That's a great idea. It's scary.
What if there was a big spider in Lord of the Rings?
Could it be a sexy lady?
Well, how else am I going to ejaculate?
The Spidey boys. The arachnophilic boys.
Gary, has anyone... I know it's late in the episode to introduce extremely powerful new philosophical concepts, but is there anything between ejaculate and jack-o'-lantern?
Ejaculantern?
There we go.
Yeah, there's
is
great,
that just a jack-o'-lantern with cum dripping out of its mouth?
Yeah, I think that's an ejaculantern you can fuck. That's a good portmanteau.
Or is that the name for the goo inside a pumpkin?
No, because it doesn't... It ends with the wrong thing. It ends with lantern.
Okay.
I like that idea.
No,
because it's not a lantern. It would have to be like a pump lacculate or something like that. The portmanteau is not as good. You know what I mean?
I do know what you mean, but like, I don't know. Yes was there.
I don't think it works. It ends with lantern. It has to describe the pumpkin.
But it's still, when you hear jack-o'-lantern, you still think pumpkin. I'm admitting there's a jump there, but it's a jump that a child could make.
Do you got batteries for that Walkman? Because I don't think so.
No, I was too busy listening to Lightning Crashes.
Throwing Copper.
Is that the name of the album?
Yeah. I listened to that album a bunch as a kid. It's fucked up. if people like the show, what can they do?
They can go to patreon.com/duckfeedtv to financially support the Duckfeed Network,
mm-hmm.
of which this is a part, to its enduring shame.
It is a great network and a great part. Support people like Gwen.
Yeah, support Gwen. I like Gwen.
Yeah, Gwen's great. And support Cole. And Dennis Furia. And you get a bunch of bonus episodes and things if you want
Gary,
to.
Gary, pivoting away from having to name more people on the level.
Oh, I know all the people on the level most days.
Uh-huh.
Yael Prendes.
Sure.
Benjamin Merkel. And then Moxie. They go by now.
Okay.
I think that's all of them. Maybe like a hidden level person, a bonus level person. I think that's all of them though.
Oh, Gary, we didn't talk at all about the secret level show.
Fuck. I know. That looks like such shit.
It looks like such dog Nothing looks shit,
good.
Dude.
Nothing in it looks like a good version of its thing.
I really want to see the Spelunky one to see if they actually make something that looks cool.
I don't know why the animation in that does not look like it doesn't feel like it embraces a lot of different animation like, styles. Everything looks super hyper detailed.
Everything looks like a fucking Blizzard.
Yeah.
Cutscene. To be very clear, real fast, we're talking about the trailer for Secret Level by the new Amazon show they're making that is set in existing video game universes. It's a short film anthology.
Yes.
And everything. God, the fucking Mega Man in that made me so mad.
The trailer is also really annoying because it's like, you know these worlds. Mm-hmm. You've been with these characters.
All the chosen ones. We chose them all.
Yeah, it's really, really pandery and gross. It looks like shit.
It looks like shit.
You can also leave us a rating review on Apple Podcasts or Podcast Addict.
Like this one left on Autumn M on Podcast Addict. Very excited to see the energy on the podcast the first time Gary goes full coal and talks about building a shed or something. And that's a 5-star review.
Hypothetically, if I talked about building a shed, how would you react?
I would make quite a bit of fun of you, yeah, I think. Yeah. That's
You'd be
my baseline
surprised,
reaction.
At least part of it, right? Like, I build a shed, doesn't it? It's pretty out of character.
It does seem very out of character, yeah. I don't think of you as someone who builds anything.
No, I'm not a builder.
Except, of course, the concept of plausible lockhorns, which I acknowledge here in legal sense that Gary Butterfield is co-author of and architect of and is better than me at, and I will never say otherwise.
No. Not better than you at.
As good as all
Thank
the time.
You. Thank you.
At least as good as. The thank least you. Is important.
thank you. No ghost.
No ghost. We're going to get this fucker fixed. You're the fucker. I'm your therapist.
Mm.
good Marge Coda there, buddy.
Mm.